Hey everyone, welcome to Alpine Online. We hope you had a great Easter.
We're excited that you've joined us today. And I gotta tell you, something happened to Natalie and I this week that was just really cool. God put the exact same verse on our heart at different times. And I just believe it's a word from the Lord that God has given you. And I'm excited for you as a church just to have a chance to hear what God has put on her heart and for you to have a chance to share with our church.
Yeah, I'm super excited to be able to share with you this morning. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us today.
Yeah, we love you guys.
We miss you guys. Have a great day.
With all we have,
the case of hell will never stand a chance. Your name prevails, Jesus, the great I am. No word will fail, no weapon formed against. Your name prevails, Jesus, the great I am. The case.
Whose promise we know we can hope, and we can have this confident expectation that God will be going with us and going before us every day of our lives, and He's been doing that for generations. And for thousands and thousands of years, this blessing has stood in Scripture. I'm going to have Sam read that for us before we sing this song.
May the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord show you his favor and give you his peace.
Children, may his presence come for you and behind you.
always go before us, that you always be behind us to catch us when we fall and to stand beside us, knowing that even the strongest storm, even the deepest valley can be weathered because you are with us. That is the favor that you have shown to the people that you call a chosen generation. That's been your promise for thousands and thousands of years, and we hold to it and cling to it today, God. Show up in every household right now. Make yourself present. Make your favor present. Make your mercy present. Make your grace that says it's okay to come just as you are, present and real and alive, to every ear and every heart that hears this today. Go with us this morning, Lord. Amen. As we've just sang a declaration about the favor of our God and the consistency of his presence, let's take a moment to listen to some stories about how faithful God has been to his people.
I grew up in a home where I was able to see the joy, real joy, of what it looked like to follow Jesus. And at the age of 5, my dad was putting me to bed. I had a lot of questions about God and heaven. I wasn't confident that I would go to heaven when I died, and I wanted to be sure. Through these questions, my dad shared the good news and the love of Jesus with me. I immediately accepted Jesus into my life, and the feeling was absolute joy, the best. I just received the ultimate gift. Now I want other people to experience the same confidence, peace, and joy that comes from knowing Jesus. Because there's no better life. The best part is that from the moment I accept Jesus into my life, he made me a new person, gives me a brand new identity. If someone were to ask me, who is Ricky Rizak, I would confidently say that I'm a deeply loved child of God. Because I am his child, that also gives me a perspective of him, of God. So who is Jesus to me? He's my dad. He's also the perfect example of how to love and how to live. Living for Jesus and having him in my life has been a purposeful, fulfilling, rewarding, and joyful life. The absolute best life ever. And I wouldn't give it up for anything.
I grew up in church and really grew up believing that if you were good, good things would happen to you. And when that proved to not be true and bad things happened, I started very early on to believe a lie. And that lie was reinforced repeatedly until it became my identity. And it was the lie that I saw life through and every situation through. And that lie was that I was not worthy of being loved. And because of that, it led to many years of really poor decision-making and a life of partying, people-pleasing, and being super productive, thinking that if I could just accomplish a lot and be successful, it would make up for all of the partying I was doing. So while it may have looked like I had a lot of good things going on for me inside, I was really being swallowed by darkness and I hated myself. And Jesus was pursuing me. I could definitely feel that, but I just kept convincing him or trying to convince him that I wasn't worthy. And telling him all the things, all the reasons why I wasn't worthy. And any person who came into my life who challenged my belief, any friend or relationship, I would push away and sabotage before they discovered it on their own. And I got to a place so dark and so isolated that I really didn't see a way out. And that's when Jesus came in and made it so clear to me that I was worthy and gave me a new identity as a child of God who is deeply, deeply loved regardless of anything I could say or do. And he took away all the shame, all the guilt, all the condemnation and replaced that with a love I didn't even know existed. And I still struggle with that lie, but he has just put so many godly people in my life who remind me of who I really am. I don't know what lie you're believing, but I do know that if you surrender that to Him, He will take that away from you and He will give you a life better than you could even have imagined for yourself.
I want to tell you a story. So growing up, you know, I grew up in the church, was baptized, you know, president of the youth group, you know, went to Bible study, went to church every Sunday. But my actions and the way I was living wouldn't have reflected that I was a follower of Jesus. And, you know, I think about the verse, Matthew 15:8, you know, they honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. And that's how I lived the first 25 years of my life, where I honored God with the things I was saying, but the things that I did, the decisions I made, the actions that I had didn't align with who Jesus was. And when I was 25 years old, that's when, you know, Jesus really, you know, stopped me in my tracks and showed me that I wasn't truly, truly living for Him. And, you know, I think about it as clear as day. I was sitting down and, you know, I read Romans 10, verse 9. You confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. And the big part for me is a belief, because my actions weren't in alignment with what, you know, with who Jesus is. And I can say now today that Jesus came in and He's changed everything from my life and everything in my life. And I can, you know, I can look back and see the changes that God has made and the peace that I have knowing that I have Jesus. And I want to encourage you guys who are trying to follow Jesus or who don't know who Jesus is, try Him out for yourself and seek Him, and He will find you and change everything for you.
I wanted to take just a second and share something that is so important to me. I grew up in a Christian home, and I grew up following Jesus and truly loved Him with all my heart. And that carried with me throughout my adult life. And just a few years ago, you may or may not know our story, but our fifth son, Zion, was given a fatal diagnosis. And that darkness and that pain was something I never imagined happening. I never ever saw the need of a Savior so badly. I never saw that desperation until that darkness hit me. And in Hebrews 6:19, it talks about, we have this hope as an anchor for my soul. We have this hope as an anchor for our soul. And that truly is what brought me to the realization that all of my years, all of this life that I've lived, learning about who Jesus is and following Him, has anchored me that not if the storm might come, but when the storm, that not like, you know, what if this might happen, but even if the worst may happen, that I still have an anchor of hope, and that Jesus is my hope. And Jesus has become the absolute hero of my life, because I could have never survived as a mother losing her son and walking through grief and loss. And it feels particularly like sorrowful today, because I think about Jesus, who made the ultimate sacrifice, and I think about Mary, his mother, and grieving the death of her son. But the story doesn't end there, and He was the sacrifice for all of us, and He was raised again and brings hope to all of us. And that is the living hope that I lean on. That is the living hope that I can be assured that my Zion is in heaven, that God's promises are true, that He is faithful no matter what. And so today I wanted to share that hope with you. I wanted to share the hero of my story, who is Jesus, and how He has restored my soul and brought back my joy and the laughter that I can have, because I know He is the true hope. And as we go through these difficult times, whether you feel like this is really difficult and you are facing hardships with friends and family members that are suffering, or if you're just, you know, a little inconvenienced and uncomfortable with the quarantine, I get it, we're all in different camps. But regardless of the now, Jesus is our hope in every situation. Jesus is our hope no matter what, and He has proven that to me, and I wanted to share that hope with you.
It is so good to hear your stories of how God is meeting you and showing the hope of Jesus to you, even during this uncertain season.
Yeah. So to those of you that were bold enough to share your stories with us, thank you so much, because what you're sharing is a story of what God is up to and an encouragement to all of us here at Alpine Chapel. My name is Alex Gowler. I'm one of the staff pastors here, and this is my wife, Renee. We're so glad that you decided to join us today. We're looking forward to hearing from our very own Natalie Mudd here in a few minutes. And also, if you're a family joining us, make sure you stick around for the Alpine Kids Ministry video that'll play after the message.
Yeah, and now whether you joined us for the first time last week for Easter, or whether you have been doing Alpine at home digital this whole quarantine, we are so grateful that we get to spend this time with you and your family.
And if you're just jumping in with us over the past couple weeks, we would love a chance to connect with you and to send you a little welcome gift from us to you, just to say thank you for being with us. So stay tuned to the end of the message. We'll give you some instructions on what to do to receive that gift from us.
Yeah, and we would love to connect with you right now, wherever you are. So online hosts, go ahead and get this started. I want to know, where are you right now? What's your location, and who are you watching this with this morning? Yep.
And so as you guys are doing that, we'd also love to share about some of the awesome opportunities that we've been able to be a part of during this season as a church.
Yeah.
We have a reputation in our community of being a place where people can come to find hope. And we've been seeing that as people are stepping forward with needs, not just the township and the school district coming to us with needs, but individuals who need help paying rent and utilities. And as all of these needs have come in, we have had an equal number of people from Alpine step forward to meet those needs, because this is a generous church. We say all the time, generosity is our norm. So thank you to those of you who have continued to give in this season, even above and beyond, so that we can meet the needs in our community during the season. And we want to continue to be that kind of church.
Yeah, it really does make such a huge difference. So if you want to take a moment right now and be generous, I want to invite you to follow those instructions right here on the screen, or click that give button, and you can do that right now as well.
So once again, thank you for being part of our service today, and we're looking forward to hearing from Natalie Mudd on her message, Don't Waste the Waiting.
Good morning, everyone. I am so honored to share with you this morning. Last week, it was so sad not being able to gather together as a church family for Easter, and it will definitely be an Easter that we will all never forget. And I am super proud of our team here who put together such an amazing Easter experience for all of us. And I did not realize when I was watching the video just how emotional I was gonna get when that drone came down, came through the doors to an empty lobby, and then to the laptop, and seeing all of your faces that sang in the choir, I completely lost it. It made me realize just how much I miss all of you, and I cannot wait till we're together again. Last week, Dave shared a message about hope, that hope was meant to be, that even right now, Jesus is always at the right place, at the right time, and he is with us. And that is so encouraging, because we need to know that he is with us right now. Over the last month, we have experienced so many new changes. Some of us have started working from home. And if you have little kids, you know how difficult that is. You have little coworkers that are right there interrupting your work nonstop. For some of us, we have become homeschool parents. We have become teachers overnight. I being one of those, I never would have thought that I would have become a homeschool teacher. And for some of us, we have been forced to stay home and not to work, and that is so difficult. And for all of us, we have been given this new set of rules to follow when we're going into a store. There is the social distancing lines, it is wearing masks is the new norm, and there is just so much new. New is all around. And if you're anything like me, who likes to have it all planned out and likes to have structure and kind of know what tomorrow is going to hold, this is difficult. It has been so challenging. I've had so many ups and downs. And for me personally, I've had some good days and some really bad days. About a week ago, I had to go to my kids' school. My older ones are on e-learning, and my younger two are still doing the packets where you have to go to school and pick it up. And so I drove to the school. I'm waiting in the school line, and I am sitting there watching all these teachers that are wearing masks and gloves, bringing out their work, and I am just crying. I am so emotional thinking that this is our new norm. Like, what is going on? And it made me so sad just to realize just this new change and not knowing when this end is going to be. And so that day, later that day, God laid on my heart this verse in Isaiah, and it is the verse that I want to speak on this morning. And it is in Isaiah 43:19. It says, "See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way." I want to say that again. "I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland." Now, I want to give us a little background. I want to back up to Isaiah 42. God has just, in Isaiah 42, has just rebuked the people of Israel for their blindness and their deafness to who God is. And there becomes this pattern with the people of Israel where God delivers his people from Egypt, and even in their lack of trust and them worshiping idols and living out of fear, he still makes a way for them to the promised land. And then again, it repeats all over again, where the people of Israel again find themselves just doing their own thing, and then they're crying out. They're in captivity in Babylon, crying out for help. And so in Isaiah 43, God is reminding them again of all the promises that he will be their God and they will be his people, but they need to trust and they need to follow him. And it goes on to say, "See, I'm doing a new thing." He's telling them, "Do not perceive it." And he's just calling them again to listen, to hear, to trust again. And the way he is making is always back to him. God loves his relationship with us. And our scripture this morning is reminding us that God is making a way in the wilderness. He made a way back then for the people of Israel, and I believe he is making a way for us today. And I think for most of us, we can see pretty clear what is going on, all the new things, all the new changes. But my question for us this morning is, are we perceiving this new thing through fear or through faith? And I think God making a way for us isn't going to look like what we think it's going to look like. See, we, in our own way, we want it perfect. We want it figured out. We want it next day, all these things. But when God is making a way, he is working, and it's not going to look how we want it to look. But again, we don't know what tomorrow has, but what we do know is what scripture says, what God's word says in Romans 8:28. He says, "And we know that all things," again, all things, "God works the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose." And I love his word and those reminders. So this morning, I want to share two things with us as we are waiting for God to make a way. And the first thing is, don't waste the wait. I don't know about you, but in this season, I don't want to get past everything we've walked through and not be changed. I have been praying and just asking God just to reveal my heart, show me the things that I maybe need to surrender to him, that I maybe need to let go. And I know that our waiting looks different for all of us right now. And all of our dynamics at our home are so different. It is, I know for some of us, crazy. Again, some days are great and other days are not so good. But I want to encourage us again that God is working in the waiting. He is making a way, but are we taking the time to see it? What are we filling our wait with? I just want us to ask ourselves that question. Are we like the people of Israel, filling our weight with our own selfish desires or temporary fixes? Or are we filling our weight with things that are causing us to be fearful? Or are we filling our weight with faith, putting our faith and trust in God and what His Word says? You know, I love looking at the Bible for examples of this, not wasting the weight. And I found the passage about Paul and Silas where they are thrown into prison. And instead of being fearful while they're waiting, they turn the prison into praise. They decide in that moment to worship God. And I can't help to think when I'm reading this, if I'm thrown into prison, I do not think that I would be singing praises. I think I would be crying if I'm just being honest. But I love that Paul and Silas have this opportunity in the waiting, and they decide to praise God. And we could look at Joseph, who is sold into slavery by his brothers. And in the waiting, he let faith be his foundation. And God was still using him all along despite what was happening to him. And Joseph didn't let what happened to him in that waiting period defeat him. And God made a way through his whole life. And that was because Joseph continued to trust and obey God through his whole life. And even when Joseph at the end had every right to have revenge on his brothers for what they did, he chose to love and he chose to forgive. And that itself, I think, is so difficult if we go back and we look at the life of Joseph and all that he had to experience. And in that moment, he decides in the waiting, even at the end, to love and forgive. It just blows me away. So I want to encourage us, don't waste your wait. And Dave has been encouraging us as a church to be present with Jesus, to be present with family, to be present with community, and be present with mission. And the second thing I want to talk about is our witness in the wilderness. What will be our witness in the wilderness? We can look at the life of Jesus and see that he was also in the wilderness. And in the wilderness, we are reminded that he was tested, that the enemy himself was speaking lies, painting this picture of all that he could have. And the enemy himself kept on telling him to worship him. And Jesus says in Matthew 4:10, "Away from me, Satan, away from me. Worship the Lord your God and serve him only." And we could see that it wasn't easy for Jesus. And yes, he was tempted, but he didn't believe the lies. He chose to worship God and not the world. He chose to worship God and not the world. And I think the same is for us. We have a choice. Are we going to worship God, or are we going to worship the things of this world? I don't want to be like the people of Israel, where I'm going back to all my old selfish ways. I want to choose God's ways. And I love going back to the wilderness. There's the imagery of the wilderness in Scripture. It's always a beautiful picture. Yes, sometimes discipline, which is not fun, but a beautiful picture of God drawing his people back to himself. I love that picture. And God making a way for us isn't always to better our circumstances, though that would be good. And it's not, him making a way for us isn't always going to be answering every single one of our prayers. It's not taking all of the troubles away, though that would be nice. It's God bringing us back again to the beautiful way, and that is back to him. Again, in the waiting and in the wilderness, he is with you and he is making a way. and the choice is ours. Will we choose God or will we choose the things of this world? I want to read the scripture again that I read in the beginning, Isaiah 43:19 again. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. And you know, today, I know that there are some of us who might be feeling that you've lost your way. Maybe you've let fear control you so much to the point where it has crippled you. And I want to say to you this morning that there is hope. There are some of us today that you are feeling like you just lost your way. And so you have turned to things like drugs, alcohol, pornography, maybe food, trying to numb yourself from what is really going on. And I want to say to you, there is hope. There are some of us today who have known Jesus maybe for a long time, but you are mad. You are actually angry. You have allowed maybe the pain from your past to just control where you are today. And I want to tell you today that there is hope. Today, there are some of us that have completely lost hope. And you are in just a place of hopelessness. And I want to say to all of those things, there is hope. And today, you can choose Jesus because his way is the only way that brings eternal life. The choice is ours. And it's simple, and it's beautiful, and it's offered to all of us. The Bible says if we confess our sins to God, and he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I want to say to you, it's not too late. It's not. Don't give up. And don't give in to the things of this world like the people of Israel. Choose God's way because it is the best way. And it's the way that is guaranteed hope for tomorrow. As a church, we have been saying over and over that hope is a confident expectation of a better tomorrow, based on the character and promises of God, that he is who he says he is, and he will do what he says he will do. I want to pray for us. God, I thank you so much for every person who is watching this morning. And God, for that person who is crippled in fear, God, I pray that right now they would put their faith and their trust in you. God, for that person right now who is medicating with all of the wrong things, I pray that today they would choose to turn away and take your way. God, the way that leads to eternal life. And for the person who is angry and mad and feels pain, God, I pray that you would just bring a peace. Help that person to know that you are with them, even in the midst of what they are facing. And God, for the person who is just in complete hopelessness, I pray today that they would experience the hope that only you give. So God, I pray that we wouldn't waste the wait, that our witness in the wilderness would be one that chooses you and not the world. God, help us. We thank you that we have you and we have this hope. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
I worship you. working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. Oh, you are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in these ways. I worship you. I worship you. 'Cause you
waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
You and I.
Wow, it's been such a good morning together, and thank you again for taking the time to be with us.
Yeah. So families, in a couple minutes, our kids' ministry video is going to start. But again, guests, thank you so much for being part of this service with us. To get that gift that we talked about earlier and to connect with us, go ahead and follow the instructions that your online host will provide in the chat or comment section, or you can also text ACLZ to 97000, and we'll go ahead and get you connected and get you that free gift.
Well, thank you for spending your morning with us. We love you. We are with you. Yes. Have a great week.
See you, everybody.
Everybody, I'm Jake. I'm really sorry if I look or sound funny today. My shirt's really tight, and I'm afraid if I breathe out, I'll pop a button. I gotta breathe! Today, I'm gonna talk to you about humility. Humility is putting others first by giving up what you think you deserve. One of the ways I like to put others first. So you're probably thinking that the smart thing to do would be to change shirts. Well, I already tried that, but none of my shirts fit today, or any of my clothes. At first I thought maybe I had gained a little weight. I mean, I have been eating a lot of mustard-filled donuts lately, but even my shoes don't fit, and I don't think I gained any weight in my feet. Almost got it, almost. Or my head. I don't know what's happening right now. Wait a second. I bet one of my friends is playing another April Fool's Month surprise on me. They switched all my clothes with smaller versions of my clothes. Man, that's elaborate. I gotta do something now. That's the rules of April Fool's Month. Somebody does something to me, I've gotta do something back. Something big. Something that's never been done before. I'll put a bucket of confetti over the door. So whoever walks through will get a bucket of confetti all over them.
Yeah, Jake, you're a genius.
Nope.
Easy, boy.
So, today's story is about how we should treat people like they're more important than we are. I can't wait to try that after I prove to everyone that I'm the best at April Fool's Month surprises. Yeah. How many buttons does this thing have?
The Bible. It's 66 books of history, stories, letters, and poetry that fit together to form God's one big story. The epic adventure of how He created us and loves us so much that He made a way to rescue us. As we travel through the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, we discover people who met God and found their lives changed forever. And now for an amazing story, inspired by the book of Philippians, chapter 2, verses 3 through 8.
Jesus' life and death and resurrection changed the way everything works. It changed how we view others and how we treat them. One of Jesus' followers, a man named Paul, wrote about it in a letter to believers in Philippi. Don't do anything only to get ahead. Instead, be humble. Value others more than yourselves. As you deal with one another, you should think and act as Jesus did. Jesus was equal with God, but Jesus didn't take advantage of that fact. Instead, He made Himself nothing. He did this by taking on the nature of a servant. He appeared as a man. He was humble and obeyed God completely. He did this even though it led to His death. Let's imagine how this truth might play out today. Angus McCrane had been up since 5:30 a.m. for his job as a school bus driver. After three morning routes, he skipped lunch to clean out throw up and a spilled soda from the back of his bus.
Yuck.
Then there were three afternoon routes and a whole stack of paperwork waiting for him at the bus garage at the end of the day. So by the time Angus got home, he was starving. He couldn't wait to dig into this delicious ribeye he'd picked up.
Gonna fire up that grill right away.
While the grill heated, Angus prepared a baked potato and sautéed green beans.
A little salt, a little lemon.
Then he seared the steak to perfection and slid it on his plate alongside the fluffy baked potato and crisp green beans. Ooh.
Ah, thank you, Lord Jesus, for this food. Amen.
Angus sliced off a corner of the sizzling steak and skewered it with his fork.
Ah.
But before he could take a bite,
oh, for goodness sake.
With a regretful glance at his steak, Angus headed over to his front door and opened it. His new chipper neighbor Marge stood there, holding an enormous Siamese cat.
Hello, Marge.
I am so sorry to barge in, but I just found out about a super last-minute work trip, and I don't have anyone to watch Boris while I'm gone.
Angus just stared at the cat, and the cat stared back, smugly, as if he knew Angus hated cats.
Well, I gotta tell you, I've never been around cats much.
Oh, that's no problem. I've got everything you need right here.
Angus looked past Marge to see several bags and boxes, plus an entire carpeted climbing tree.
So, could you do it?
Angus glanced sadly at his quickly cooling steak, but he could see Marge was a little desperate.
Well, okay.
It took Marge nearly 10 minutes to explain every little detail of Boris the cat's care. Finally, Angus was alone again with his steak. And Boris.
Yeah, better keep those fuzzy paws away from my dinner, you hear me?
But before Angus could take a bite!
Ah, what on earth?
Angus jumped up and hurried over to the side window. He could see exactly what had happened.
Ah, that boy.
Zachary Kircher was a kid who lived next door. He loved sports, but didn't have good aim. He'd already dented Angus's car with a baseball and destroyed a patch of petunias playing soccer. And this time, it was a rogue football that had hit the window.
Huh. At least didn't break the glass.
Angus saw Zachary scrambling to recover the football and make his escape, but as he tried to hop the fence, he stumbled.
Serves him right.
When Zachary got up, Angus could clearly see that he'd badly gashed his knee. Angus sighed, thought mournfully about his steak, and opened the window.
Zachary!
Sorry, Mr. McCrane, I'm leaving.
No, just hold on a minute. We gotta clean up that knee.
So Angus grabbed his handy-dandy first aid kit and headed outside. It took another 10 minutes to clean out all the dirt from Zachary's scrape and get it all bandaged up, and finally, Angus sat down to dinner again for the third time. His steak was barely warm.
I am so hungry I could eat the entire cow.
But before he could take a bite.
Oh, that don't sound good.
Angus ran to the front window. It appeared that the neighborhood ice cream truck had swerved to avoid Zachary, who had ran into the road to chase his football. Big no-no. And now that truck was listing sideways on a flat tire.
You have got to be kidding me.
Angus opened the front door and headed down the sidewalk. The poor teenage driver was checking out the damage.
It's my first day on the job. I wrecked the truck. They'll fire me.
No. It's just a flat, son. You wait right here.
With a deep sigh, Angus headed back to his garage, grabbed his handy-dandy toolkit, and showed the young driver how to remove the flat tire and replace it with a spare.
Thanks. I'd totally give you an ice cream sandwich, but they might fire me for giving stuff away.
Angus wiped the grease off his hands as he watched the ice cream truck ramble down the street. Speaking of ice, his dinner must be stone cold by now.
Excuse me?
Angus jumped a mile to see Marge standing behind him. She was wearing oven mitts and holding a hot apple pie. Steam seeped from the cracks.
I can't eat this since I've got to leave. I thought you might like it.
Well, glory be.
Angus inhaled the heavenly smell.
First I interrupt your dinner, then you help that kid next door, and now changing a flat, You sure put others first.
I don't generally feel like doing it, but thank you.
Angus happily accepted the apple pie. This time he would be putting dessert first while his dinner reheated in the oven. Now, it would have been a lot easier for Angus to just eat dinner and ignore the people around him who needed help. But little by little, God was helping him serve others, just like Jesus did.
Okay, so the bucket of confetti is set. As soon as someone walks through the door, the bucket will fall and they'll get covered in confetti. But let me think for a second, because something doesn't quite fit right. I'm supposed to think and act like Jesus did when he was here. Well, how did he think and act? Jesus is like God's only son, but instead of staying in some big heavenly castle, he came here as a baby and then grew up serving people, helping people who were sick, teaching people who wanted to learn. Then he died for us and came back to life. So how did Jesus think? He thought that people mattered a whole lot. And how did he act? He loved and served and gave up everything for people. Gave up what he deserved for me. And you know the rules. Somebody does something for me, I've got to do something back. So I took the confetti myself so no one else would have to. I mean, it's not even a big deal. I like confetti. And these aren't even my clothes. Sometimes putting others first gets a little messy. But you know what? That's okay. You don't put others first because it's easy. You should put others first because that's what Jesus did for you. That's the one thing I learned today. Put others first because Jesus put you first. I'm gonna say that over and over again so I'll remember. Put others first, cause Jesus put you first. Put others first, cause Jesus put you first. Love others, cause Jesus loved others. Like your family, your friends, your brothers, your sisters, your mother, your gardener. Put others first, cause Jesus put you first. Man, I feel like brand new. It's like putting on a fresh pair of clothes, except clothes that actually fit. Ugh. I'm gonna need to change. I am getting confetti in my lungs. See you next time.
Myself and I, laying down my pride. Gonna put somebody else at number one this time. Don't wanna be in a world where it's all about me. I'll take second to whoever is around me. I'm giving up my number one position. Don't wanna be